Good afternoon. Hear these words of hope from the Psalms. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys to unlock the doors of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. My friends, we are here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Harry Blaine, husband, father, relative, and friend to you all. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Let us pray. O comforting one, compassionate one, be with us all when we suffer loss and ache with the pain of grieving. Give us a glimpse of the way it will be when love will never be taken away, when life itself will not be diminished, when all that we hold most precious will live and remain with us forever. Amen. As I talked with Lisa, she picked out a few scripture verses that I will share with you today. I did get her to wheedle it down just a little bit. From the prophet Isaiah, have you not known, have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. God does not faint or grow weary. God's understanding is unsearchable. God gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. From the psalm, we turn to David's psalm, the 23rd. It's a very familiar one, often, well, almost always read at funeral services. But it is really poetry, but it's really a poem, a prayer for those who remain and how we can live our lives with the protection and the guidance of God. If you know it, you can pray it with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. And the lesson from the gospel, and it's the gospel of John. It is during the last meal that Jesus is reported to have with his friends. And it is when he is telling them that he is going away or he's going to die. And he wants to give his friends comfort. And by giving his friends comfort, he gives all of us comfort. And these are just a couple select verses from John 14. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I don't give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." I am the fill-in pastor for the pastor who is going to do the service, who has come down with COVID. Thankfully, I am still well. And though it was a little iffy yesterday, I wasn't sure, but just fine today. So the family did put together a little bio, 4 pages long, a little bio that I will read to you and share. Harry Blaine Mimnall, born on March 16, 1951 in Hagerstown, Maryland, was welcomed by his parents, Harry and Dorothy Mimnall, and sister Candy. He had a very happy childhood filled with lots of family time and play time with relatives and friends. His sister remembers him as always being happy. He attended weekly Sunday school classes and had a love for sports and played Little League for years. He was a Cub Scout and later became a Boy Scout. He also joined a youth bowling league. He would go on to bowl in a league well into his 20s. He had a wide circle of friends, and one of them, Jeff Martin, helped him pull a prank on his mother and sister. They sneaked a guinea pig into their house and then laughed with delight when the critter ran into the kitchen, causing his mom to scream and his mom and sis to jump into the counter. He would join the varsity football team in high school. Blaine helped with household chores from an early age. He washed dishes, shook rugs, made his bed, and helped cut the grass. He would later cut grass for neighbors. With the money he earned, he purchased his first car, a green manual transmission Plymouth Barracuda. He thought he was so cool, and by all definitions, he was. The family pet, a long-haired chihuahua named Chipper, was drawn to Blaine and became his little protector. When one of his grass-cutting customers patted him on the back for a job well done, Chipper thought he was being harmed and bit the neighbor in the leg. Blaine had many fun times in Ocean City, Maryland. He would often travel there riding on the back of a friend's motorcycle. In later years, after marriage and children, he would take his family on annual beach vacations where he taught his daughter how to boogie board and his son to build sandcastles. I bet he did more than that, but he met his future wife, Lisa, at the Broad Axe Tavern. I'd really love to know about that one. In Hagerstown, Maryland in 1975. But this was not the first time Blaine had laid eyes on her. In fact, he would reveal years later that he had been admiring her from afar for quite some time. Blaine shared that he would watch her running in late for work almost daily from the restroom window that overlooked the entrance to Pangborn Corporation. Following Lisa's move to Hagerstown later that year, the courtship really began to blossom. Blaine and Lisa would continue to date until he finally mustered the courage to ask Lisa to take the plunge and be his wife. The two were married on June 4th, 1977 at the United Methodist Church in McConnellsburg, Pennsylvania, and celebrated the occasion by honeymooning, and where else but Ocean City, Maryland. Blaine and Lisa would save for 2 years and finally purchase their first home in 1979. After some much-needed TLC, the house became a home. They would welcome their first child, a beautiful little girl named Rachel, in September of 82. The family was complete when they welcomed their handsome little boy, John, in August 1985. The foursome would then move to a much needed larger home in February of 1986, where many wonderful memories were made. Blaine built his kids a swing set where they spent many happy hours, and every fall would rake the leaves in the yard so that Rachel and John could run and jump in the piles, giggling all the way. Blaine would accept a job at Computer Power, Inc., and in 1993, the family relocated to Ponte Vedra Beach, Florida. While Blaine missed his family and friends back home in Maryland, the sunshine and warm weather were a welcome change. As Blaine always did, he immediately began to make friends. He developed a close relationship with his next-door neighbor, Dick, and would regularly compare yard appearances, bordering on a competition for who had the best-looking lawn in the neighborhood. Blaine would spend the rest of his life in their home on Oakview Circle. Outside of the day-to-day hustle and bustle, Blaine would find many ways to enjoy himself and show love and support for his family. He was so thrilled to be able to coach his son's soccer team for a number of years. He relished being able to teach his daughter how to drive for the first time, taking her to an empty school parking lots for practice and to ensure that no one was injured. He instilled his love of sports in both his children, taking them to numerous baseball, basketball, and football games, as well as NASCAR races. He even showed his kids how to place a bet at the track. Okay, God. He would watch his children grow up and leave for college, and when the house was empty, he found joy relaxing with Lisa in his recliner, watching a variety of home improvement shows, reality TV, and of course, movies. Some of his favorites were Duck Dynasty, Mountain Men, Moonshiners, Flip or Flop, that's a house thing, Yellowstone, Game of Thrones, and Vikings. Once a week, you could find Blaine sitting in his comfy chair, drinking from his Yeti with his loving Jack Russell Rescue, curled up in his lap watching Barbershop for the millionth time. If you couldn't find Blaine inside the house, chances are you would find him sitting in the garage playing music from a boombox, throwing back a couple cold beers. In April of 2020, Blaine bid the working world goodbye. With a short and sweet email and a toss of his key card, he retired at the age of 69 from Black Knight, Inc. And Blaine would then pass away peacefully in his sleep just last week, January 9th. Is that last week or this week? Last week. At his home, relaxing in his favorite recliner. We're certain he has been reunited with his parents in heaven. He will forever be remembered as a devoted husband, loving and caring father, cherished brother, beloved son, loyal friend, and helpful neighbor. Blaine touched so many people, and they are the better for having had him in their lives. He will be missed deeply by all who knew and loved him. I have to say, in all my ministry, that is probably one of the nicest family remembrances of a man that I have ever seen or read. I'm wondering if there are any other remembrances that you would like to share. A story, a memory, a touch. Well, then, I'll have a few words to say. One of the prayers that I did not pray today, written for our funeral services, includes this petition. Give to us now, talking to God, because it's a prayer, give to us now your grace, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. That might, on the surface, seem odd. Death, a mystery? We sit here before it right now, this minute. Death. It is all too real. Blaine was here among you, and now he's not. Our lives go on, his does not. Not as it was, at any rate. We as human beings understand the concept of breathing and breathing out. And we understand that when the breath stops, so does life. We know that our lungs give out, hearts give out. We have diseases that can't be cured and diseases that can be cured. We live and we do know that we die. So, what is the mystery, we ask? Not one of us truly knows what happens after we stop breathing. When my mother died, did she in fact know that I ran out to find a nurse to aspirate her, thinking that she was just had, you know, something caught in her throat? Was she hovering over her body, watching me and my brother and his wife as we contemplated where to go to dinner? Did she join her beloved mother, who she had lost when she was in her mid-30s, as well as her other siblings and father? Don't you wonder that about Blaine? Is there something more to this God business than just fantasy and wishful thinking? Is there life after death? Will we see our loved ones again in some way? I'm a minister. I wonder that all the time. I really do. For Christians, the answer is yes. Though I do believe that yes is not a factual yes, because that's what faith is about. It's having faith in something we don't know for sure. I mean, I know I'm standing here on a platform. I have faith that I will see my mother and father again someday. When we talk about life after death, we say, I believe that there is something beyond the grave. I believe when Jesus says that he goes to prepare a place for us, that he goes and does that. When Jesus says, because I live, you will live also. I believe that's true. I believe Jesus when he says, I will come again and will take you to myself. In Jesus' final discourse at his last meal with his friends, he speaks of his death, of his going away. He has said this before with his friends protesting. He told them, I'm going to die. And Peter says, no. And then Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. Because Peter would have it not be so. They don't want him to die. He is their life. He is their purpose. He is their breath. They are so like us. Don't go. You can't die. What will I do? What will my purpose be? The thought of losing our loved one is incomprehensible. So what does Jesus do? He assures them, don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. Believe, he says. So simple to say and so hard to do for so many people. He assures them that his death is not the end, but the beginning. His life may end as we understand life. He lived and he died, but death will only lead to life in a new understanding. Added to that is God's Spirit will teach us about what this new life is all about. We are not left on our own. He assures us, I will not leave you orphaned, he said. Or another way of saying it is, I will not abandon you. I am coming to you. Isn't that one of our greatest fears? Of being abandoned, of being left alone. Our spouse dies. We suddenly don't have him with us. We are alone. Your dad dies. You can't go to him and say, teach me how to. You can't. He's not there. The fear of being left alone. I know it has always been one of my greatest fears. Jesus' words continue, though, with a blessing of peace. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, but a peace that is beyond understanding. It is a peace that comes in the midst of sorrow and anxiety. A peace that comes even when the world, our world, seems to be falling apart. It is not contingent, Jesus' peace, on what's happening around us. It is only contingent on what God is doing within us. It is a peace that comes sometimes at the strangest times. It is a peace that can overwhelm us even when the world is falling apart. And there is peace. Are you afraid? Are you without hope? Are you without faith? I do believe that God understands perfectly and still will never, ever leave us. You are not alone. You are not abandoned. God is with you. Paul, I think, wrote it so poetically in the book that's called Romans, his letter to the Romans. He wrote, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Will anything separate us from the love of God? No, he writes emphatically, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation. He wanted to make sure that he covered all the contingencies. Will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Because he died, we live and are never alone. Amen. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we dare to trust you. And to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. Amen. O God, all that you have given us is yours, as first you gave Harry Blaine to us. Now we give him back to you. Receive Harry Blaine Mimnick into the arms of your mercy. Raise Harry Blaine up with all your people. And then receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Amen. And let us pray. We thank you, God, for this day. We thank you for Blaine. We thank you for his family and friends who witness this day the life that he lived among us. We thank you, God, for all the people who have shown us love in our lives. We thank you, God, for your love, which will never end. And we pray, God, that your mercy will follow us all the days of our life. And that never, ever should we have the burden of feeling that we have been left abandoned, but that your love will follow us wherever we go. This we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus, who is our Lord and Savior, as we pray the prayer he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Christ Jesus our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. And now to conclude the service, we will hear the song that was one of his favorites, Blaine's favorites. Thank you.
those conclude the service. On behalf of the family, I'd like to thank you all for coming and showing your love and support.
Put some work into that. Would you like this back or?
Sure.